Okay, Mr. Bhatt, are we ready? Mr.
Yes,
Bhatt,
sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
are we ready?
Yeah, we are ready, sir. We are ready.
Okay, so we can start now. So just a few words. So first of all, good afternoon to all of you. And thank you for joining the another very important webinar, that is the use of LT architecture, LT structure in our Indian Railways. So today we are having the team for the presentation on this LT network, use of LT network in, and its application in Indian Railway from Nokia. And I welcome Mr. S.N. Bhatt and Mr. Mahipal. So without wasting any time, I request both of them to please start with their presentation. And I request them to please thoda detail mein jo hai humko guide kare ki how this LT structure is going to be used and how it is the future of Indian Railway in comparison with what system what we are using in at presently. So thank you, and please start with your presentation.
Definitely. Thank you, sir. So
thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Garg Saab, and the complete team. So I will welcome the complete team, and thanks for giving us this opportunity, a platform to present our complete LTE solution for railways. So we are already engaged with railways from last many years. So I am SN Bhatt. I am heading the sales from the transport segment from Nokia. So with me, Mahipal is heading the solutions. So we will be running the presentation. So we have this small introductory part on the Nokia and the Nokia's activities in global and India. And thereafter, the complete LTE architecture and the detailed presentation, and also the how to migrate, and what are the planning parameters, and what are the use cases, and also some IoT applications. So we want to completely cover, which is around 1.5 hours. So if there is any questions or this thing, kindly raise in between. So we will support you. Over to you, Mahipal. Please introduce and carry on.
Yeah, hi. Thanks, WhatsApp. So hi, this is Mahipal. And I am basically looking after the technical solutions end to end and heading the solutions for Enterprise India. So in this presentation, we just try to cover, you know, basic about like what is, as WhatsApp mentioned, about our presence in India and globally where we are placed, as well as the basic of LTE and what are the use cases architecture. So I will cover all those aspects in, you know, in further slides. So any questions, if you have any questions, you can interrupt me and ask those questions. So this is about Nokia's position globally. In the current slide, you can see we are number one in 4G radio, that is LTE radio, a number one in supplier of that. Same is for the copper access and in services also. We have our own telecom software development team, and so we are number one in telecom softwares also. So Nokia is a, you know, a multinational company, headquarters based out of, you know, Finland. It's a Finnish company basically, and we have offices in almost 100 plus countries. And India is definitely one of the most important and significant country for Nokia. So in India, basically, 1/4 of the, you know, Nokia's headcount actually resides in India. So this is, you know, one of a very, you know, for as a Nokians, it's a prestigious thing for me. We have almost 7 to 8 corporate offices in India, along with 20 plus project offices in all the circles, basically. In this corporate offices, we have a headquarter in Gurgaon and multiple offices in Gurgaon, Delhi, Noida. Similarly, we have in Mumbai, Bangalore, and Chennai. We have a manufacturing plant also in Chennai, where we produce and manufacture basically the E-Nodebees and the radios. And a very, almost like 5 million E-Nodebees we already supplied from there. We have a strong R&D workforce based out of Bangalore and Chennai. So this is basically, they are involved in the development of the softwares related to the LTE, 4G technology, 5G technology. And, and we have labs also in Bangalore. We have a lab in Chennai. We have lab in Gurgaon. We have lab in Noida. So we have multiple labs where we actually, perform these tasks. This is about the Nokia's position in India. We are number one market leader in core and access, number one in optics, and number one in GSMR also. This is more about the R&D. R&D, we have a strong headcount in R&D also in India. We have more than, applied for more than 400 patents since 2012. And we have more than 6,000 plus, employees just dedicatedly for R&D. This is again about our manufacturing plant. So we again adhere to the Indian government guidelines of Make in India. And we manufacture 4G and 5G radios in our Chennai factory. From here, we cater to the customer requirement based out of India, as well as we, export from here to the other part of the, globally we are exporting from here. This is about Nokia's deployment in GSMR. We have deployed more than 3,400 kilometer of GSMR network in India. And in this, this consists of like total 8 contracts are there of, different kilometers, I can say. So here, this is the picture depiction of that, where we covered, like where we supplied or deployed our installed our GSMR network. this is about the track lengths we covered. Like in NCR, we have deployed 420 kilometers of GSMR networks. Similarly, with NR and FR, we have almost 800 plus kilometers in NR and ECR, NCR. So totally, adding all this, it becomes more than 3,400 plus kilometers. So Nokia is kind of like only the vendor or supplier who supplied to the Indian Railways for GSMR. And this is about the LTE. So I will just try to cover the basic of the LTEs, from where LTE comes as and what are the terminology we are going to use in the LTE. So LTE basically is a technology we called as long-term evolution. And this LTE, people are more aware about the term 4G. This is fourth generation of mobile technology. So first generation basically is our normal telephony. Then GSM came into picture. That is Global Cellular Mobile System. And then 3G. We all are aware of the third generation of mobile technology. And this is the 4G. And 3GPP is the body. That's the third generation partnership project. This is the body which is responsible for publishing the standards for these technologies basically. 2G, 3G, 4G. So all these standards are, draft, finalized and published by 3GPP. So they maintained it. And these are again based on open standards. So let's come back to the LTE again. So LTE basically we have two components and making them it becomes EPS. So EPS is evolved packet system, in which EPC is evolved packet core. That is the core part, basically a centralized equipment. And second is the EUTRAN. So that is the air interface basically, or the equipment which are responsible for the wireless part. So making these two components, it become an EPS or LTE technology. So architecture in this LTE technology is very simple. Centralized, you have one place, you have core, and then you have the remote locations. You have the BTS or E-Node B or remote side equipment, you can say. So in 3GPP basically, so 3GPP we have like the memberships is there. So like all cellular operators are member of 3GPP, equipment manufacturers like Nokia and other manufacturers. Also the device manufacturers like Samsung and other manufacturers are also there, as well as the software developers and chip and components like Qualcomm or Samsung. So these are all are the members of 3GPP, which actually contribute in some another to the 3GPP standards. And LTE basically, excuse me, there is some noise coming from, okay, thank you. Many, in 3GPP, basically in release trial, 3GPP has published the public safety support. So this public safety support, when I'm saying, they have included, incorporated the public safety features also. These features are like group call features, which are there in other narrowband technologies like walkie-talkies, etc. One-to-many call, one-to-many video calls, proximity, like device-to-device services are there. Mission critical push to talk, we called it, like it's based on the quality of services required for such mission critical networks. Same is IOPS, isolated EUTRAN operation services are there. So there are different services are introduced in release 12 and above, and those are specific for the public safety or mission critical networks. So this is how 4G evolved. 1991, 2G was introduced. We understand it from the term second generation of the mobile or GSM. So 2G was 100% circuit switch technology. Access was 2G. And from 2G in 2000, 2.5G, we called it GPRS also, General Packet Radio System, and EDGE also, Enhanced Data GPRS System, evolution you can say. So the major change basically from, CS, in the 2G, 2.5G, the PS packet switch system was introduced basically. So this packet switch system, what happened? This become a introduction of IP there. And also, as we understand, from 2G, the data speed was only 9.6 kbps that time. And when we, you know, evolved in 2000 to the 2.5G or edge was introduced, the data speed, maximum data speed we achieved is of 64 kbps. So we remember our old phones of like, you know, this MotoTalk and Nokia Talk, those big phones with, you know, just sending a message and small messages we were able to send. And then MMS was introduced. Those were the time when 2.5G was introduced with the introduction of packet switch. Now, you know, with the progress of time, our data requirement, you know, enhances, or you can say increased by multiple folds or exponentially increased. So we understand we required a system which can support us at higher data rate. So release four in 2004, basically release four was introduced. This is the introduction of 3G technology. We also called it wideband CDMA, so WCDMA. In this, yes, circuit switch was there, packet switch was also there, and the IMS, integrated multimedia services, is introduced. So IMS is basically required for, you know, for the backward compatibility to the GSM network, as well as for the other integration with other telephony services and other multimedia services. This is required. However, still, we are using both circuit switch and packet switch technology in the 3G. The good part is release 4, the throughput we were able to achieve that time is 384 kbps. So with that, release 5, there's a further enhancements, new features were introduced like HSPA, MIMO. In release 6 and 7, HSUPA, HSC, you know, DPA, all these features, HSPA plus, these features were evolved, and the data speed in release 7 with the WCDMA in 5 megahertz, we were able to achieve of 11 Mbps downlink and 5 Mbps uplink. That was a huge data speed that time. Still, it was not able to suffice our requirement. Yes, the technology was evolving. Most of the, you know, components are going towards packet switch because of the latency and other requirements. So release 8, there's a new access technology introduced that we today call as 4G or LTE. So release 8, it's the first, you know, introduction of LTE. This is the major difference, is this is a 100% packet core technology. So there is no circuit switch data. IMS is only required for the backward compatibility. Like backward, when I'm saying with the 3G or 2G network, as well as with the PSTN or IP, or, you know, other telephony networks. In other terms, it's 100% packet or IP technology. Release 9, 10, today on 2021, we are sitting on the 2021. So from release 8 today, the release 16 is published in 2020, December 2020. So today, we are offering to our customers is release 16 of 3GPP. Now, in this release 16, there is a, you know, some aspects from the 4G are there. Also, the introduction of 5G was there since release 15. And there's an involvement of 5G in release 16. So release 9, 10, 11, 12, these all are the releases of LTE. So with each release, there is an optimization of the features happened, optimization in terms of devices also, optimization in terms of infrastructure also. Like in release 10, there's an introduction of features, carrier, you know, advanced carrier feature is there, and there's a, you know, carrier aggregation feature is there. So that's why we call it LTE advanced technology. So carrier aggregation, what happened earlier, we were just able to use a single slot, 5 megahertz or 10 megahertz or 20 megahertz. In release 10, we were like, when there's a higher throughput requirement is there, we can combine this channel like 5 megahertz or 10 megahertz or 15 megahertz, combine this channel like 5 or 10, make it a 15 megahertz of channel to, you know, cater the higher throughput of a particular customer or particular user. So all these features were introduced, like in release 12, I explained the public safety features were there. So this is more about, you know, basic features which are more related to us or public safety or railway environment, I'm saying. So release 8 to 10, voltage, quality of services, as mentioned, a high speed train, definitely it's there, 350 kilometers on, etc. From release 11 onwards, there's a high power UEs, we call them, you know, class 9 UEs basically. So those were also introduced. So with every release, there is an enhancement in data throughput, both for uplink and downlink. The devices were also evolved, and these devices, they support higher data throughput with the newer infrastructure. and release 12 explained this is for public safety basically. So features related for mission critical were introduced in release 12. Push to talk call, and this push to talk call is also, this PTT call is also not like a normal call. This is also based on a quality of services which are required, you know, to provide a high quality of experience to that mission critical user. Like the call setup time. The call setup time is less than 300 milliseconds. That's a very small time. But yes, the call will establish in less than 300 millisecond time. Push to talk, this call will go to many users. Like push to video call is there. This call will set up established in less than 300 milliseconds. And there are other features which are like, you know, all the packets or all the, I can say the data related to this mission critical applications will have a special treatment in the LTE infrastructure or in the public safety mission critical networks basically. And in this, they defined the QCIs. QCIs are basically quality call identifiers basically. So these are the classes, you know, quality class identifiers. So these QCIs define the quality of service required for that particular application or service. So every infrastructure vendor or every OEM have to adhere to these QCIs if he is providing his network or infrastructure or devices to any mission critical network. So release 13, 14 is further enhancement in these features. These features evolved and the new, you know, additional requirements added in this. Just give me a moment. FRMCS is basically Future Railway Mobile Communication System. So this was supposed to be, you know, this is supposed to be published in release 17 now. And this is more related to the railway specific functionalities. So here they will define, like in this draft, basically, they defined all the requirements of railways along with the signaling system, integration with the signaling system, and other functionalities which are required for, you know, daily operational and functional, you know, requirement of the railways, I can say. Similar, all these features which are there in the public safety releases like group calls, you know, push to video calls, all these features are also there. Plus other functionalities like controller, location-based services, functional number alias, all these features which are required for, you know, railway functionalities are there in the FRMCS draft basically. So I will go to the EPC architecture here. So okay, so in the previous slide I explained there are only two components. One is as a centralized location, another one is at a remote location. Remote locations are the eNode Bs, which called as a BTS or node B in the 2G and 3G. So this is responsible for the, this eNode B is basically providing you the LTE bubble or a coverage bubble or a wireless part basically. Whereas centralized equipment EPC consists of your HSS, MME, serving gateway, packet data gateway and PCRF. And all these are just the software plus hardware component. And these I'm showing here separately. However, these HSS, MME, Serving Gateway, PDN, and PCRF, they together makes a EPC, and they are going to be in a one rack, two rack, three rack, four rack at a centralized location, at a common location. You can place them at different locations also, depend upon your requirement. However, these all components together make the EPC and can be placed at one simple, one common location also. These are having different functionalities. Let's start with the HSS here. HSS is the database basically. So all your user database registered here. So it basically maintains, provides the subscription data, or you can say user identification handlings. And MME is responsible for, you know, mobile mobility entity. This is actually responsible for the mobility management of all the users. Also the control data, when I'm saying the signaling data or the control data of LTE network will come to MME always. From any user when he initiate a call or try to latch to a particular network, so MME authenticate that user, okay, this user is a valid, he authenticate that, and after that all the NAS signaling as well as, you know, the bearer management All those things are basically taken care by the MME. Serving gateway is providing a gateway to all the internal eNodeBs, I can say. So all eNodeBs terminates at a serving gateway. Control data go to the MME, whereas all the traffic data or the user plane data comes to the serving gateway. Packet data gateway is responsible for, this is basically the external IP point of the network. So any information which needs to go up the network to the external world, like any application,
my ball. Hello.
Hello.
Not able to hear Mahipal. Hello.
Hello. हाँ Mahipal जी आवाज नहीं आ रही.
हाँ नहीं आ रही अभी. Mahipal, I think yes. Hello. Hello. Just a just 1 minute, he's just, I think there's some connectivity. Hello. Mahipal, not able to hear. Hello.
But can you call him? Hello.
Sir, just called him. Just called him. He said he's, I think, some.
Okay.
Just hold on. Mahipal, now it is slide, I think, is moving, but we are not able to hear your voice. Hello, Mahipal, if you are speaking, we are not able to hear.
I need to reconnect. So
yeah, now it's coming.
Oh. And now it's coming. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's coming.
Okay. So are you able to see the screen or?
Now it is blank.
Okay. A moment.
Yeah.
Is this visible now?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Yeah, now.
So. Okay, sorry. This is some network issue I'm not aware of. I hope I was on this slide, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So I was saying, I was explaining, I think, packet gateway and PCRF, right? So for PCRF, basically, this is responsible for policy charging rule function, enforcement of the all the policies, basically, in the network. So policies. Network. What happened when in Airtel network, somebody buys a prepaid pack, and that prepaid pack, there are certain rules for that, right? That he can make 50 SMS, he can send 50 SMS, or he can download 1 GB data in 24 hours, let's assume. So, and with a 5 Mbps of data speed. So when he download that 1 GB of data, let's assume he download that 1 GB of data in just 10 hours. So what will happen? There's a policy defined for that user. Okay, if he download or consume 1 GB of data, then his throughput from 5 Mbps will decrease to the 512 kbps. So these kind of policies are defined in the PCRF, and these policies they enforce. Like after that, when that user try to download any data, then he will get a maximum throughput of 512 kbps only. So he need to buy a new pack or whatever, need to recharge, you know, get the actual speed. So this type of different policies, basically, I'm saying, are defined in the PCRF. So all these component, HSS, MME, serving gateway, packet gateway, and PCRF, this totally makes the EPC. Now, eNodeB. eNodeB is responsible for the wireless part. So eNodeBs are connected back to the EPC through the optical fiber, IP/MPLS network, or can be connected through satellite also, or can be connected through microwave. So eNodeBs are multiple eNodeBs are there. Each eNodeB actually have some coverage area. Depend upon the requirement or depend upon the clutter, it actually generates the RF signal, which gives a coverage to a area. And users who are there, like UEs, user equipments, mobiles, which are there in that coverage area, use the wireless interface, communicate with the eNodeB, and then eNodeB send that data back to the serving gateway and further to the other networks as and when required. So I will explain or cover those part in further slide. So these are the like logical interface between these components. So already explained. So let's go to the other slide, right? So in this slide, you will see the UE, basically the user equipment or the mobile part. Then the infrastructure part comes here, eNodeB. So this is a physical equipment again. And then the S gateway and T gateway. So I'll just explain how the call will happen. So at any time, the user basically when initiates a request, so radio bearer is always assigned till that eNodeB through that wireless interface. We call it UU interface here. So in this, basically also the S interface. So this basically EUTRAN interface. So in this, basically there's a setup is there, the wireless connection established, and then there's a S1 interface between eNodeB and S gateway, basically. Now this connection is, I mentioned, it can be IP/MPLS or microwave, so there's a backbone connectivity is required. Now this EPC, so S gateway and packet gateway, these are there at one common location. Now once radio bearer, suppose he wants to make a call, this user equipment basically wants to make a call to some application. I'm just giving you an example, WhatsApp message. So this user opens his phone, opens the WhatsApp application and send a one picture. Now how this picture will be sent through this network. So the first, this UE and eNodeB interface is established, and then with S gateway and P gateway. So here you see this EPS bearer. EPS bearer is basically, this is related only to the EPC, basically the network part, LTE network. So there is a one GTP tunnel formed basically for this part. Like radio bearer, S1 bearer, and S5/S8 bearer. These are the interfaces basically. So this tunnel is formed. Now WhatsApp server, this application pair, or this is mentioned here, this is your application server for the WhatsApp. Now packet gateway is your external IP point for the external world. So this packet gateway is connected to the WhatsApp server somewhere through the internet, basically, I can say. And this can be at any places. Now this external bearer connected to the EPS bearer, and this makes an end-to-end services. So this tunnel is formed. The session is actually formed from UE to the WhatsApp application server and the vice versa. So once this is established, then this UE is able to send messages or whatever through that EPC bearer, EPS bearer, as well as with the external bearer. So this is how the call has happened in a system. This is more about the group call or PTT call solution. We called it mission critical push to talk call. So this is how it happened. In the extreme left, you are seeing this is a user device or the mobile devices which we are using. In mobile device, we are having application client, similar to like we are having apps in our phone. For shopping, we are using different apps like Amazon, Myntra, Flipkart, etc. And for chat, we are using WhatsApp or Signal and these kind of apps, so WeChat. So MCPTT is also an app. So once you open it, it will cover like provide you all the functionalities. So this mobile device through the wireless interface is connected to the eNode B. So this is the radio access part or the tower, basically. This is the eNode B. Now from here, the user data will go to the S gateway, whereas the control data from here will go to the MME. So first, MME authenticate the user. From the database, it check, okay, this is the user, hit authenticate. Only then from S gateway, the data will go to the packet gateway. Now, here two scenarios comes into picture. The first scenario, the call, whoever has initiated the call, that call is intended for an internal network or for the external network. So I'm just giving you an example of operators here, like Airtel. This user make a call. This is an Airtel user, and he actually initiated a call. So when this call is initiated for another Airtel user who is in the same network. Now for this, what happened? The call will go to the eNode B, from here to the S gateway. Now this S gateway will itself decides, okay, this is a call for Airtel user, another Airtel user in my same network. So instead of going to other component, what it will do, it will just go to the packet gateway, come back and send that to the other Airtel user. So this is how this call will complete it. And the policies are, again, this is required, policies needs to be enforced for that user. And similarly, if that Airtel user initiate a call for other operators user, like Vodafone user, in that condition, this will go to the eNode B. From here, it will go to the S gateway, then to the packet gateway, and then from packet gateway to the packet gateway of the Vodafone network. And then from that packet gateway to the S gateway of the Vodafone network, and to the eNode B of the Vodafone, and then to the user of Vodafone. This is how the call will happen for the different operators, basically. So they have an integration between each other's P gateways are connected to each other, basically. Now, third case is here with the telephony also. So telephony, what happened? These are connected to the fixed line exchange also. And this is about the PTT solution. So PTT, we have a MCX solution. We call it mission critical push to talk or push to video services. So this is nothing. It's an application server, which resides again, all resides the infrastructure. And all these applications, this is similar, like we have WhatsApp server, we have other application servers, Amazon servers. These all are nothing. Those are just the applications. Similarly, MCX is also application. So the call from packet gateway through a standard SGI interface. This is a telecom standard interface, open interface, through which we connect to the external world. So it go to the MCX server and then to the respective. It's intended for, if it's intended for other walkie-talkies, or it's intended for PABX or PA system, then through the call bridge server, it will go to that IPPBX or other systems and vice versa. So this is how call happened in this system. This is about the integration between the, ETCS level 2 and LT, which we proposed in NCRTC. So here,
may I interrupt you for a minute?
Yes, sir.
Please, please, sir.
I'm a CST planning owner. Just a small query in the last slide.
Yes, sir.
If there are two users in the vicinity or in one eNode B, then even then the call has to be routed through S gateway, or the eNode B has the capability of switching the call within the jurisdiction of itself.
Yes, sir. So eNode B does not have that capability. The call will go to the S gateway.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir. So in this also you see this eNode B basically, and all these are the EPC part. Now in the loco basically we have onboard unit as well as the bellies are there, the sensors which are there on the track basically, which will provide information to the loco OBU, and there is also LT OBU in this. So through this LT OBU the call, like the data, will go to the eNode B, and then again the same flow will happen to S gateway, packet gateway, and to the application server. So we need to understand there's a LT infrastructure, that is EPC, and there's a wireless part. For wireless part we have eNode B, and then the devices, and at the back end of the packet gateway we have all the application servers or other network. Sorry. So in a nutshell, basically LT is providing you the broadband pipe. So this broadband pipe is for the packets basically. So from one end you can send the packets up. So LT will provide you that pipe basically. This is again the same illustration in terms of protocols, how, like, you know, what are the responsibility of LT, what is the responsibility of signaling vendor, and what is the, you know, in terms of protocols also. I will just pass this slide. So for me, every data I can say is simply packets are simply bearers, nothing else. So those are packets or bearers I can say for that LT pipe. So bearers, you know, I manage the bearer at one end, fix them, and deliver to the respective destination through that broadband pipe. So this is a nutshell about the LT.
Mahipal, you can explain the TCAS similar to the ETCS too.
Yeah, correct. So TCAS, yes. So TCAS is an application, right? TCAS is nothing, it's just an application for me. TCAS is also having a loco TCAS OBU basically. There's a OBU TCAS in the loco. They called it loco TCAS. That is nothing. It's a LTE mobile or user device, I can say. So that device send a loco messages to the eNode B and then to the EPC. And from EPC, we will send that message to the respective or stationary TCAS. So in TCAS, every station will have a stationary TCAS, they call it, or station TCAS that manages a kind of, you can say, left side block or right side block basically, and the data will need to go to that particular stationary TCAS. The difference between normal scenario or ETCS to or TCAS is, TCAS is a distributed technology or a localized, I can say, which manages a local area, whereas in ETCS to is a centralized technology. So the bellies or all those, you know, and the decisions are also taken locally.
Your voice is breaking, yes. In between, please check your connection.
The station.
Mahipal, your voice.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can hear. In between it has to.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, audible.
Yeah. Okay. So ETCS and TCAS are just a bearer for me and nothing else. So simply I just pick a bearer from a onboard unit. Respective OPU. the thing which I am providing here, definitely the data requirement for TCAS or ETCS is very small. However, latency plays a major role here. Latency, when I'm saying, yes, the delivery of packets in certain time. So the latency in the 3G, LTE technology is less than 10 milliseconds. So within that 10 milliseconds, I will pick the packet and deliver it to the respective destination. So this is one of the beauty of, you know, LTE. These are just the redundancy slides basically. So redundancy is possible in terms of EPC also, like we can have the replica or geographical redundancy of the same equipment at one station and similarly to the other site also. What we are like in discussed with RailTel or Indian Railways also, they are planning to have two EPCs, one as a main EPC, second as a redundant EPC. So the main EPC components, all components should be replicated in the geographical redundant location. So this and these are kind of in an active configuration. So that is also possible. And their database are always in a sync, like the main, any change happened in the HSS, it will happen or it is always in a sync with the redundant core. So that change also happened immediately at the redundant core also. So these are in kind of active mode. So this second scenario is again about MME pool. So MMEs of both the main as well as the redundant core, can we work in a MME pool also? MME pool means, you know, some of the users can use the like the main MME and the other users can use the redundant MME simultaneously also. So like their resources can be pulled into a common bucket and can be allocated discretely to each users. So irrespective of like users, they can be latched to any MME. So this is how we can provide a redundancy in the MME also. This is about the RAN redundancy. RAN redundancy, we are having a multiple ways to achieve this. One is like, hardware redundancy. Definitely every site we can put multiple hardwares also in an active standby mode also or active mode also. So in this slide, I just tried to cover. You will see I use the color scheme here, the blue one and the orange one. So this is one site I can say. So in this one site or one station, you can say this is one or two E-node Bs. The blue is one E-node B and orange is the second E-node B. Now there is a coverage from the blue E-node B. So this blue E-node B, you will see there's a coverage like from RRS3. So there is a coverage on the this side also, and there is a coverage on the right side and the left side also. So similarly, the same coverage from the other E-node B, that RRH4 is there, the orange color coverage. So if any of the hardware fails, you still have the coverage available from the other color E-node B. Even if orange fails or if blue fails, there's coverage available from the RRH4. But for this kind of scenario, we need at least two frequency channels. Whereas now railway is providing us only with the one frequency channel. So this kind of coverage redundancy is not possible. So in NCRTC, we propose similar configuration. However, in that configuration, blue is active one and orange is there in the locked state, like it's not transmitting. So as when blue fails, the RRH will, the orange color will start transmitting. So this will wait for, failure of blue one. So this is how we actually provide the hardware redundancy in this NCRTC. This is the second type of redundancy. So this is basically coverage overlap redundancy. So here you will see, I am just using single E-node B at one station or one location. So there's only a blue or a orange or blue, that's it. There's no like, I'm not using two hardwares. Now in this, what I planned my cell sizes like that, the coverage from orange, you will see from here, coverage, it will go to the RRS3 site also 100% and go to the RRH1 also. Now this RRH2, there's a coverage coming from RRH1 also to this location. Similarly, there's a coverage from the RRS3 also. Even this RRH2 fails, there is always a blue coverage available from the adjacent site like this. So in this you will see there's a blue and the orange coverage. So there is half of the coverage overlap is there. And in NCRTC, we again, hardware redundancy is there. Along with that, they also ask for a coverage redundancy. So both scenarios, like first scenario and second scenario, both are, you know, considered in the design for the NCRTC. Now in this, you will see if this blue fails, even that the orange color continuity is there. Similarly, if orange fails, there's a blue coverage continuity is there. So this is called adjacent site coverage. However, in LT, we will not get the same throughput. Still, the coverage is there. Now in NCRT, I'm just giving you NCRTC example here. NCRTC asks for 4 Mbps of downlink throughput and 2 Mbps of uplink throughput in normal scenario. Normal scenario, when all are functional, in this scenario, all are functional, there is no failure, then we need to provide them 4 Mbps up, downlink throughput and 2 Mbps uplink. However, if any eNodeB fails, let's assume this orange fails, right? This orange fails. In that condition, the throughput will decrease to the 2 Mbps downlink and 1 Mbps uplink. However, this is the minimum throughput if one of the site in between fails. Like, let's assume this orange fails. If this orange fails, even this coverage area, like this coverage area, I'm still getting 2 Mbps of downlink throughput and 1 Mbps of uplink throughput. So that's the minimum requirement. So we designed as per these criteria for the NCRTC. So they have no single point of failure. They have multiple level of redundancies, I can say. So what is Nokia's proposition? So the architecture here, it's like not in the terms of module. Here, this is a very clear architecture. So this is the LT devices, like your mobile devices or onboard units, basically, or user devices. And these are connected wirelessly to the eNodeBs here. That is in part of the infrastructure. And now there is LT core. So these eNodeBs are connected back to the LT core through optical microwave or optical or IP MPLS. And now this LT core basically is connected to the application servers, which resides outside the infrastructure. So through packet data gateway, basically. So this is the basic architecture. So very, very simple architecture, I can say. And LT dispatcher equipment, this is also kind of a application server for it. Now, very this is a very flexible deployments, I can say, and provide you the end-to-end LT services. And this infrastructure which we are proposing, basically Nokia is proposing, is future evolution or to upgradeable to the 5G also. This is our portfolio. So we have a certified partners for ruggedized devices. So these are the devices which comes with a hard push to button on the side of these devices, and these are ruggedized IDN standard specified onboard units which are there for the loco, providing the LT functionality in the loco. And these are the eNodeBs basically, and radio access part, and we have the core. So we have a different tiering of core available with us. So from small core to the core which can provide or maintain a nationwide pan India level also. Along with that, we have applications and transport. We have our own IP MPLS portfolio, along microwave and a satellite backhaul portfolio also, plus the all the security products, like providing the security required in the networks, net guards, contain security, firewall. All these are our own products, along with the professional services, like consulting design for RF planning or deployment of these networks, optimization, care, or this, we have a professional services available with Nokia. So this is like Nokia is having end-to-end complete portfolio required to deploy a network. So this is more about the core. Core is the EPC part basically. So we have a core available from two server core. This two server core will provide you all the basic functionalities. We call it enterprise core also. And to a core which can cater to a complete pan India level. So that is a multi-level core, and that can cater like crores of subscribers, I can say. So this kind of like scalability we have, So based on requirements and you know, we always dimension the code. And our core is basically you know, all like enterprise code to the main core. Reliability is always, or the availability is always the five nines. That is you know, the one part. And second is the services. So both are kind of like, you know, equipped with the public safety features also. They provide all the all are as per the 3GPP standards, the pooling, like the network functions, cloud solutions are available in from enterprise core to the bigger core. All the components which I said, like MME, PCRF, S-Gateway, P-Gateway, those are the softwares, and those softwares in a virtualized form resides in these servers basically. Possibility are there, they can be in the two servers also based on the configuration or dimensioning, and they can go up to like multiple rack solutions also for, you know, bigger networks. So these servers which you are seeing here, these are Nokia's own quad server. We call them airframe servers. So these are for storage as well as the computing servers. So both are actually offered from Nokia. This is our access portfolio. So we have a, you know, variety of access or eNodeBs, I can say, and depend upon the requirements, terrain, etc. We propose different type of radios. So on the extreme left, we have Flexi Multiradio 10 BTS. So this eNodeB is basically world's smallest eNodeB with such a high power and capability and capacity. This can cater up to 36 frequencies. The toil cross pipe, I can say, in per sector we can go up to 12 you know, frequencies transmit, and transmit 12 frequencies per sector, I can say. So total in three sectors we can transmit 36. Even we can create six sectors also with this eNodeB, and this is one of the smallest. This is IP65 eNodeB. You can mount it on the top of tower, very small form factor. And there's a eNodeB consists of two modules. One is radio frequency module, another is basically the system module. Radio frequency module is basically a power amplifier, I can say, and at the back of it is having a jumper cables or connectors to connect to the antenna basically. And whereas the system module is processing of the signal basically, all the computing etc. happened in the system module. And through system module is connected to the either south router, basically the transport connection port is there in the system module, as well as all the computing capacity, all these things are there in the system module. Now this eNodeB is connected back to the EPC or S-Gateway through the optical dimension. Now this is also RRH, we called it remote radio head. So what happened? One system module can cater to multiple remote radio heads. Like here you will see the radio is there, the same radio frequency module of the same size is there with the system module. Now some places customer wants, or you know, depend upon the requirement, they said we want to have that system module or baseband module, we call it BBU, at a common location, and I will just put this RRH. This RRH of having a smaller capacity as compared to this RFM. When I'm saying less capability capacity, but it's too much to suffice anybody's requirement. Like we can transmit 44 or 4 transmitting ports are there. We can transmit 4 frequencies even in 3 sectors also. So these are like 2T, 2R, 4T, 4R, different configurations are available for these RRH also. So one system module can cater up to 12 RRH. This kind of configuration is also possible. So you no need to buy a baseband module for every site. Instead of that, baseband can be placed at some common place. And just put this RRH on the top of tower and connect it back to the PBUs basically. And this is very small. These are equipment. So these can be mounted on the top of tower in the outdoor also. So, and this is our latest portfolio, AirScale RRH and AirScale Multi Outdoor System Module. This is basement module or system module. We can mount it in the outdoor also and indoor also. And this RRH is, you can mount on the near to antenna basically. This is the power amplifier basically. Now This is the latest one. This is upgradable to 5G. So this supports 4G as well as 5G. And the good part, now our all radios with the base stations in roadways you are seeing here, this same hardware can be used for 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G. We call them as a software-driven radios. This you don't have to change anything. Only the software needs to change in this flexi multi radio. That's why we call it flexi multi radio. So if you put a software of 2G, this will work as a 2G equipment. If you put a software of 3G, this will act as a 3G node B. If you put a software of 4G, it will act as a 4G node B. Same hardware, no changes occurred, only the software. So this kind of capabilities in our access portfolio we have. Now, right side you see these are like the small cells to provide a coverage in areas where small area needs to be covered, like in building or maybe inside the station at some places. So these are small cells which can provide a coverage. So we have different flavors available in this also, like with the 1 watt, 0.5 watt, 5 watt, 3 watt. So different flavors are available in the small cell portfolio also. This is our group communication or push to talk portfolio, and we have like ruggedized devices. I said we have certified partners for these ruggedized devices with the hardware push to talk. These are ruggedized like IP67, 68 devices. So and with a toughened glass to use in a rough environment. Second, we have group communication application which provides the voice and the data services. So voice means group one-to-one call, private calls, group one-to-many calls, push-to-video calls, one-to-video calls, as well as other services are there. And there is also a dispatcher or dispatch console with this, which can provide monitoring to the field staff, which can monitor like and also can join any communication, group communication, whether it's a video call or it's a voice call, it can join anytime. Other features which are there in the narrowband technologies. So I will just compare with the Tetra is considered as a narrowband technology especially for mission critical. So the features which are there in Tetra, like late entry features or other features, all those features are there in the group communication or push to talk application which we are offering. So with the broadband capability also, from that you can just have the voice features. Here we are because of this broadband availability, we can also have all the data features or the video features also. And this is again based on a 3GPP standards our application. So the MCX application which we offer to NCRTC is based on 3GPP release 15 basically. So we are fully aligned with the 3GPP releases. It's a open standard and can be further upgraded to the FRMCS when the standards will be published. I will pass this. So this is about the network planning. So in LTE, actually, network planning is based on your data throughput requirement. So every service required some data throughput to run, like a group call, a normal group call or a voice call required. This is just for your illustration purpose. So a voice call required 50 kbps of data, or a video call required 1.2 mbps of data. For one video streaming, I can say, or CCTV streaming, etc. So these figures are not real. These are just for understanding. So first, we need to understand what are the services we need. And based on these services, we calculate, okay, this is our total throughput requirement. And we require this. These are the minimum services which need to be run and must require. So we always plan ourselves based on those services. So the cell edge throughput, when I'm saying cell edge throughput, so this is at the cell edge actually. Cell edge means from the E node B, there is a wireless coverage, and this coverage can go up to 100 kilometer also. 100 kilometer, you are getting at 10 kbps of data throughput, right? So in 10 kbps, you can't do anything. So your requirement, you want to have a 5 MCQTT users, you want to run a TCAS, you want to have a video streaming. All these numbers you calculate, you define these services, and based on these services, you reached out to a number. Like in this slide, I reached out to a number of 6.27 Mbps. I am having a four number of MCPTT users. Four number of trains are there, which simultaneously happening in the system for video streaming, and each video streaming is consuming my 1.2 Mbps of data throughput. Again, the voice calls for staff, I'm consuming 5 calls are happening simultaneously, and 1 Mbps with non-GDPR services, like non-GDPR, any services somebody is browsing the data or any other services they are using. Now, all these services.
Mahipal? Hello,
Mahipal ji, your voice is not coming.
Mahipal? Hello.
This is the cell range I will get with.
You are disconnected.
Sorry, what's up? Okay, you said I disconnected.
Repeat.
Now I'm audible?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm saying first we need to understand what are our service requirement. So in this slide, I just try to cover that. I just take example of like MCPTT users. 50 kbps is required for one call. I'm considering. Similarly, for ETCS, 5 kbps of data is required for one ETCS instance. So I consider 4 train are there. Similarly, for video streaming, 1.2 Mbps data throughput requirement is required. I'm considering 4 calls or 4 video streaming calls are happening simultaneously. And considered 5 calls from the staff. They are making calls to the other staff members in that time. So all these are happening simultaneously, plus 1 Mbps of guaranteed bitrate services like browsing or SIP signaling or other services which are also parallelly happening in the system. Adding all those things with the KPIs, I'm getting a 6.27 Mbps. So this is my requirement. Like from these services, this is my minimum requirement. I should get this 6.2 Mbps of cell throughput or this throughput at everywhere where I want to run all these services simultaneously. Now I got my target. So based on this target, I will cell coverage calculation I will do. So basically, I run a simulation and will see at which point away from the site I am getting this 6.27. So that is my cell edge basically for my defined services. Let's assume from a tower around 2 kilometers, I am getting 6.2 Mbps of throughput. So that 2 kilometers is my cell edge. This doesn't mean my cell or my coverage ends there. However, that 2 kilometers is, boundary, or I can say boundary for me to run all these services smoothly. Now, when I go beyond that 2 kilometers, let's say I reach to a 3 kilometers, and at that 3 kilometers, I will not get 6.27 Mbps, right? I will just get 4.27 Mbps, let's say, when I reach at a 3 kilometers. So 4.27 Mbps, I am still able to run many services like group call, this call, MCPTT call. I just need 50 kbps. 4.27 is too high. Definitely, I will be able to run these services. Yes, ETCS, definitely, 4 star I can run. Video streaming also just need 1.2 Mbps. However, at that 4.7, I can not have like all 4 video calls simultaneously. Maybe I will have 3 video calls. That will consume my whole bandwidth there. Similarly, these services are there. When I go further from that point, from 3 kilometers to 5 kilometers, let's say, and that 5 kilometers, I will only have a throughput of 1 Mbps, right? 1 Mbps, I can run MCPTT services, yes, 50 kbps. This means I can run 20 calls simultaneously. Or maybe ETCS, I just required a 5 kbps. So this means I can have 200 trains there at the same time, right? Or maybe video streaming. Video streaming now required 1.2 Mbps. So I am just getting 1 Mbps as 5 kilometers. So this service I will not able to use at that 5 kilometers away from the site. So this is how we understand our data requirement or data throughput requirement. And based on this, we actually define the cell as throughput. right, sir? So I'll go to the next slide.
Well, yeah, I have two questions.
Yeah, yeah, please, sir.
The earlier slide.
Yeah, yeah.
Is there a feasibility or possibility that if I am working at a distance of say 5 kilometers and with a compromised throughput, then can different services be prioritized? Like if I am getting lesser throughput, then service number one should be my first priority.
Correct, sir. So this is irrespective of your, you know, coverage distance, basically. So all users, as since starting, I mentioned, all users can be, you know, we can assign priorities to all users in the PCRM. So irrespective of the distance, I understand your concern. Let's assume your video streaming is critical service, right, sir? And video streaming is required 1.2 Mbps. Suppose you are at a 4 kilometer distance from the site where you are getting 1.3 Mbps of throughput. Right, and one of your somebody makes a call, somebody started to make a voice call, right? 50 kbps is consumed in that. Let's assume three users initiated a call at that from that point. So you will just left with 1.1 mbps. Okay, sir. Even when you start video streaming, all those users will be compromised and your data will get the highest priority. Your call will get through, sir. So this is how the network functions. For mission critical users, yes, we can define that for all packets. Still packet wise, we can define priorities, sir.
And number two, suppose I have planned my towers in considering some target throughput. Later on, after a few years, my throughput requirement increases. Then the additional towers would be required, or additional hardware augmentation would be sufficient.
So, sir, there are two ways to achieve that. One way is, right now we are talking of only 5 megahertz of channel through which we are achieving it, right, sir? If you will have additional frequency, then that will help you to get a higher throughput. Like currently we are talking about 5 megahertz. If later your throughput data requirement increases, so you can add another channel of 5 megahertz in it. So you can start transmitting 10 megahertz. So that will help you to get a double resources. This is one way. Second, hardware is definitely not required for that. Only a frequency slot is required and a configuration. That's it. Because this hardware, whatever I think Nokia is offering or as other OEMs will offer, will definitely is having much, much higher capacity. Second way is, yes. Second way, if you don't have the frequency available, suppose you don't get the frequency, then second way is simpler. You have to reduce the cell size, sir. That way you can achieve it. So the tower you are saying, then you have to place a tower in between. Yes, sir.
Reducing the cell size, and there is no possibility of increasing the E0B's RF powers.
That is also one way, sir. You can increase the RF power, but that can be only happen to a certain level, right, sir? Suppose you right now also you are whenever we plan to transmit at either 20 watt or 30 or 40 watt, right? So if power can we go up to maximum 80 watt, so that will not help you to enhance a great distance. Okay. I can say 300 or 400 meter can be achieved by that, or 500 meter.
Right. And this NPO service is some software,
sir. Till date, whatever the enhancements are there, maybe in future, there's a like further MIMO, all these features are evolving. So with those features, we'll maybe have with the same frequency band, we will have a higher throughput available. Maybe possibility is there. So things are improving and, I mean, say optimization is still going on, sir. And throughput, as you are saying, interference is also play a vital role. So like optimization and through that, activities also, we somehow reduce the interference, which help us to enhance or increase the, asked APIs or required KPIs. But that is default part of there in our services, sir. So whenever we deploy network and whenever we hand over network, we already, it's kind of in best of the health or best of the shape, I can say. So the optimization is, the possibility of further optimization is very, very less, sir.
Thank you.
So the way to increase the capacity, or the, you can say one is addition of extra frequency, and second is the addition of extra hardware in between. So. Okay, sir.
Right, please go ahead.
Yeah, sure, sir. Thanks.
Also, just to mention, sir, so DOT or this thing, there is also limitation of the maximum power which can be radiated.
Correct, sir.
So that limit obviously would be there.
Yes, yes. So that's why, yes, in case if the node B or the BTS is able to give the more power, so we'll not be able to radiate at that power. So there is some restrictions and limitations as well. So we have to comply to that regulations as well.
Yeah. And also, sir, we need to understand, like there's a downlink and uplink. So we need to first understand which is our, like, you know, weaker link, whether it's uplink or downlink. So this requirement, like of 6.4, like whatever the requirement, let's assume 5 Mbps. If this is on a uplink side, then even after enhancing, the power will not fulfill our requirement, because our weaker link is not the downlink. So downlink, if you increase the power in downlink, it will have, you will have a better, higher coverage. However, you are not doing anything on the uplink part, wherever our requirement is on the uplink part. So this is also we need to, you know, take care or consider while doing the planning. When uplink, I'm saying, you know, transmitting from the mobile to the towards,
yes,
you know,
yes, towards the node.
Yeah, so that we cannot increase. So this is more about the, like, coverage, cell coverage calculation understanding. So the model which we are using, or most of the OEMs, they are using this COS 231 HATA model basically. And there are different models we use, like urban, suburban, based on the clutter types. And through this, we calculate the total path loss basically. Like total path loss is in terms of the transmitting power from the, for downlink, like the transmitting power from the E node B, or I can say EIRP, that is effective isolated radiated power from the top of the antenna, which includes your gain of the antenna plus the losses in the cables or through the connectors plus the power PA, power amplifier, transmitting power, etc. So we just add and subtract the losses and the gains in between. And lastly, the U is basically receiver sensitivity. So this is how we calculate the total path loss, and on which we actually, and also the physical characteristic of the wave in different clutters is different basically. Like in R1, it's behaved differently. There are a lot of attenuation or, you know, resistance is there. Similarly, in open area, the waves can travel to a farther distance. So all these things we consider, and we have optimized model for this. For different clutters basically, urban, suburban, rural, as well as for the dense urban. So this is just one example, because LTE is based on a throughput. Actually, the calculation is based on a throughput. I explained it in previous slides, so this is same just for the reference purpose. So like when I said 3 Mbps cell as throughput, this doesn't mean my coverage ends there. So like this is just for example, at 2.5 kilometer, here 2.5 kilometer, I am getting 3 Mbps of throughput. However, if I will go away from the site, so based on the SINR, I will get a 2 Mbps of throughput on 3.5 kilometer. So this means I will still able to, you know, fulfill the services which require 2 Mbps or below data throughput, right, sir? So this we need to understand. The coverage will not end here. However, we need the minimum throughput required to run our all services at this particular point. So that's how we will define a cell edge basically. Whereas in GSM or, you know, 3G, we define this on a RSSI, received signal strength basically. So there we clearly defined, okay, I need a signal strength of minus 85 at my last point, right, sir? So this is clearly defined there. Whereas in LTE, we define the cell as throughput. So that's the difference between the, you know, 2G and 3G and LTE basically while doing the RF planning. This is more again, parameters which we consider, you know, while running or doing the cell as calculation or cell range. So this is kind of fixed now. FDDLT, this is already defined. So 700 megahertz is allocated by government. 5 megahertz is the channel they allocated. Now the uplink service rate or downlink service rate, this is depend upon our service requirements, what we need. And the base station, again, what we require, 2TR means two transmission paths are required, or three transmission paths, 4T, 4R, etc. This we need to define. Base station output power, this is base station characteristics. So we just considered 40 watt here, and base station antenna gain. So antennas are also having different gains. So mostly like whatever depend upon the vendors, OEMs, what they propose, they consider that particular antennas gain here. Now, number of sectors, this also plays like two or three sectors. So linear, generally we prefer two sectors, whereas if you want to cover the station or, you know, some area near to a site, so we always, you know, suggest to have a third sector also. Now, cab modem radio power, this is 23 watt. This is again as defined by 3GPP. So all mobile devices are basically having 200 milliwatt output power. Antenna is generally of 0 dBi, and all other are like losses. The speed we considered of train higher speed for 220 kilometer here. So if train will speed with higher speed, definitely this will have impact on the coverage also. The cell load we consider 15-15. It can be anything like 20, 30, 40. That can be defined, depend upon the requirement. However, in railways, we understand like in every E-node B or every cell, we are having a very less number of subscribers. So that are not going to consume, you know, cell data of hardly 10 or 15%. So we can consider a 15-15. It can be increased to 30 or 40, 50 also. The cell has probably tower height, we consider 30 meters. The cell coverage area is around 95%. And the noise figure 2.1 dB. So these are just the parameters I am telling you. So if we run through these parameters, we are getting a cell range of 3.12 kilometers. So inter-site distance between two towers is around 6.2 kilometers. So this is, again, you need to understand this. There, here we are considering 2 Mbps downlink and 512 kbps uplink data throughput. So when this data throughput change, or maybe the cell loading change, this will have an impact on the cell range also. So this is about like the digital communication. We are saying technology is evolving very fast, day by day is changing, sir, and it's evolving for the better, I can say. So we need to take use of this, you know, the evolvement of this technology. You need to use this technology for making, you know, our operational functional requirements and our, you can say, network management, etc., should be much, much easier. So there are things like safety is one of the highest priority, definitely the passenger safety. So that requires definitely a higher standard standard of service. From LTE, I can say the network resilience needs to be very high. The availability of network should be very high. Should be available, I can say, 100% time. That's what I can say. Second thing is, yes, stay on time or efficient operation. That is also very important. So for that, network reliability, or I can say what are the interruptions right now is, you know, we are using multiple networks for the communication. That is one of the challenge here. Automation is definitely in Indian Railways. I can say there's no automation is there. We are just updating ourselves, I can say, and that's a good part. We start adapting technology, you know, for automation of the systems. And equipment which we are using generally, we understand, like, you know, it should be updated regularly. That's what I can say. And there are other fancy services which are, you can say, on top of it, mandatory services like, you know, safety and if meeting their, you know, efficient operation, then we can also provide attractive services to the customers. How these are like few fancy services, I can say here right now, depend upon the bandwidth availability. So applications which are there, like first is the train control automation. So this is one of the mandatory application for us. It's a TCAS here. Second is the operation and intelligence and maintenance, I can say. And third is the passenger experience, which is like the third, and the, I can say this can be addressed later also. So automations is happening. industrial automation is there, definitely. Cognitive analytics are there. So based on the data collected from the field, we will have analytics and analysis tools are there. And then to based on those analysis, we can have digital operations possibility. And these can be like multi-cloud, I will say. You can have local edge. So when we are saying cloud, its understanding is always different. Most of the people, they understand cloud means this data is going outside India. It's not like that. It's just a virtualization, I can say. That can be a local cloud or a distributed as also. Like, you know, like for Indian Railways, what you are planning to have two cores, one at near to Gurgaon, second is at Secunderabad. So there you will have a virtualized core, whereas all zones can be connected to that virtualized core. So that is specifically for railways. It's like no other users or there's no third party is going to use that. So even it's a cloud, it's a core based on a cloud system or virtualized system. High performance networking is again, the dedicated deep connectivity is there. The availability of network is very much required. The efficient network is required. And second is the smart network fabric. That is again, the IP MPLS network, you know, it's already there. Luckily, Railways is having one of the smartest, or the, I can say the best IP MPLS network available today. For Railways, Europeans have already like deployed GSM MRO network, as well as for signaling, they are adopted ETCS 1, 2, and now moving towards ETCS 3. So almost 25,000 kilometer of already deployed on ETCS 1, whereas they have completed 32,000 kilometer on ETCS 2, and now the balance they have now start implementing or deploy ETCS 2 plus ETCS 3, that's kind of a hybrid, I can say, start deploying that technology. So they are like, this is again the European standard for a train control system. For connectivity part, I can say FRMCS is there. FRMCS, the standards are not published yet. Most probably by end of this year, or maybe by end of mid of next year, the standards for 5G or FRMCS can be published. So FRMCS is future railway mobile communication system. So this is again based on the technologies from the IRIN standards. Mostly this defined the functionalities of the railway specific railway specific functionalities are defined in this specs. And it's a technology agnostic. So some are like some applications are there which require a very low latency and can only be fulfilled by either LTE or you can say 5G. However, most of them are all you can say achieved through the GSM also. So those are kind of the services which makes railways operation more efficient, I can say. The converged backbone, again, IP MPLS is there, which already explained. Now train to ground communication. So this is also important. So there is a broadband systems available. Nokia is also having a solution for this train to ground. So LTE is one of them. And second is the private wireless network. Definitely that is more of a broadband or wireless network, I can say. So we have different. Third is IoT analytic for railways. So now this IoT devices, this is again picking up a pace in India also. Most of industries are moving towards automation. I'll just give you an example for this. Nokia is also, like I mentioned, we have manufacturing plant in Chennai. In that we deployed Industry 4.0. What we did basically, we are having machine to machine interface. We deployed a private LTE network there just in the factory premise. So that's just for the factory premise. So there is a private LTE wireless network. Now we have removed all the LAN cables. So LAN cables removed, all the devices are basically talking through this wireless medium. All the machine to machine communication is happening through wireless medium now. So like we have two robots, and they are called as one is Sita and the second is Janki, basically we named them. And those two robots also like fulfill the employees' requirements there, and they are again connected. They are having the IoT sensors, they are having the sensors inside them, and they are communicating through the private LTE network, basically the wireless medium, and take all the commands and fulfill them. some of the commands like, you know, in factory, we have lines where they manufacture the cards, basically the PCBs, if some component is required. So what happened, they just put a command in their system, wherever the, you know, the, these guys are sitting, they just put a command, these robots go to the warehouse, there they pick, basically the warehouse is very, very huge. There are different stacks, these protocols, like these components, electric components are placed in different stacks. Even then, by putting that command, the components comes out from the rack, these robots picks those components and deliver it to the respective station. So these kind of like automations we have deployed in our Nokia Chennai factory. So this is one of the application I'm telling you. So the, this is like, I can say, is the future. So all cables will be removed. So that gives a very cleaner look. And second is, yes, definitely the private wireless for, you know, this IoT applications for yards, etc. are there. I will cover them in the further slides. And cyber security is definitely one of our strong portfolio. So all these networks definitely required, and you know, from hacking or from any cyber attacks. So we provide a cyber security solutions for this also. LTE technology itself is having a very strong mechanism or security mechanism, so not easy to hack. However, on top of it, we also provide the security solutions that help them to, you know, having a more robust kind of safety can be followed. So GSMR is again the we deployed, however, we say this is mostly deployed in Europeans where they are using ETCS2 or ETCS1 on this. And we are having kind of like a major supplier there. So on the latest BTS, like I mentioned, Flexi Multi Radio BTS, we supplied there that supports LTE also. On GSMR, it's deployed. However, the same radio can be upgraded to LTE just with the software. So they have a huge benefit of that. GSMR, most of this network is deployed in Europe, so they have invested a lot of money, I can say, and this infrastructure is kind of in last couple of years, in last 5 to 7 years, it in whole Europe, like we, for us also, it's more than 29,000 kilometer is already covered using this GSMR network. So So this is about the FRMCS, I can say. So the major difference is about the LTE. Now in this, you will see like the sensors data or the cab radio data, handheld data, all these can be. Like in FRMCS, you will see there are multiple technologies. Satellite communication is there, 5G, 4G is there, Wi-Fi, they are fixed there. All these are nothing. These are just the access technologies. Now the 5G, 4G is most reliable technology among these, whatever is mentioned here, Wi-Fi, SAT, etc. And all these sensors, cab radio, handle, these all work with this 4G, 5G technologies. So these are different multiple tech access technologies, whereas there is a multiple access core is there, the same core, these technologies to their respective cores and then provide a mission critical communications, MCPTT and other railway applications which you require. You can customize your applications, you can develop your own application servers as per your requirement, like ticketing you want, any automation you want. You can develop your own applications and then use that applications in this FRMCS networks, or you can say this LTE 4G network. Flexibility is there. So this is one of the example of the flexibility. And once you have a dedicated railway network, 4G or 5G, you can use it for your own benefits. So this can you can reap out, you know, I can say miracle from it. So any applications which you develop, which you feel like is important for railways, which can make railways life easier in terms of safety also, all this can be, you can develop of your own, like TCAS is one of the applications. So, we are proud, like Indian vendors are making this application. So this application can run on our, low latency network of 4G. So that can provide a higher safety to the passenger. So all these things are possible using this, LTE technology. So this is very, very application-centric approach, I can say. this is about the backbone. I will just pass this. Okay. This is more about the urban railway. Now, this is about IoT analytics and, you know, for deeper insight into the railway network. So, you know, there are different devices today. So, like cameras are there, different IoT devices are there, different sensors are there. And all these are can be connected through this LTE infrastructure. The E-Node B is basically we are saying. So this E-Node B, the infrastructure, LTE infrastructure we are providing is having the capability, like it can support IoT protocols as of now, like M2M, like Cat6, all these protocols are supported by offered E-Node Bs, RF infrastructure, I can say. And these can, and we also offered a product, we called it Impact basically. So this is a platform. LTE provide you the connectivity. Impact provide you basically the analysis part as well as the you know, digital automation part. So all these different aspects can be, you know, this different I can say applications can be provided or are provided by Nokia basically. So connectivity plays a vital or major role that is achieved through this LTE network. Now Nokia Impact is basically, now there are different devices, all these device managements or protocol mediations, I can say, like different devices support different protocols, all these protocol mediations, data collections from these sensors and processing of the data is basically purpose of our main purpose of the our you know, the Impact platform here. And through this Impact, we can also have a scene analytics. So we can have edge gateways. Through edge gateways, the respective data will reach out to the respective application server, which can analyze the data, process the data, and perform the task which is assigned to that particular, assigned by that particular application server. So all these things are there, like video analytics is there. So video analytics we can use for the unmanned gate also. So this is one of the application we can use. Like in India, we are having unmanned gates are there. So closing and opening of these gates can be managed through these video sensors also. We can put a CCTV camera there, and you know, this gate can be closed if any person is, you know, trying to cross that gate when the train is coming. So that can help you know, to bridge that gap and then close that gate immediately, and help to save a life, I can say. So there are different applications using this you know, IoTs are possible, like variety of user case, like data shower, massive data downloads, you know, in the yards or factories, we can do that using the IoT applications. Connected worker is one of them. Like you can track the, you know, all your users, or you can say track the assets also. And smart asset management is also possible. So these all, like, you know, different sensors are having different applications, different use cases are there. So using this connectivity, basically using connectivity through LTE, we can achieve those IoT applications also in the network. Like predictive maintenance is also required. We can have sensors on the track side also, which help them to provide, you know, data in advanced basis also. Like if there is any crack in the track, that data, like through sensor, can be passed on to the nearest E-Node B, to the EPC, and then to the respective application server. So all these kind of application use cases can be you know, possible through the connectivities. I'll just pause this. So Nokia, yes, we are undisputed leader, I can say. So Nokia has invested a huge amount in R&D for railways. It's our legacy basically. So in GSMR also, 80% of the market share is with Nokia globally. So we already like having a huge legacy. So we are investing in LTE also, we are investing in 5G also. So we have almost 120 plus customers. Like this is just a glimpse of that. Like all the railways, you can see most of the railways are with Nokia. So we are managing and you know, providing the passenger safeties and all this, you know, through our networks basically. And this is about the future X railway. Few selected references are there. We are investing in the future technologies also, 5G, 4G, and these are with the different, you know, you can say with the different customers. So 4G and 5G pilots are already done for ATO, automatic train operations, and at the future mobile railway communication systems with Doshe One, we are already doing. We've done a trial for the Paris Metro also, where we run the CBTC signaling, CCTV, video PTT, all these applications we run on our LTE network. So lot of developments or demos we are doing in for the future also. For IoT, we are doing for video analytics and IoT for few customers. One is for this electric ER basically, and the cyber security solutions are also there. So we are like kind of investing a lot of amount in the railways. And this is about like 30 plus years of legacy for us in the railways basically. And we have end-to-end solution portfolio, like from single IoT devices to the huge EPC infrastructure, I can say. So we have all kind of product portfolio available with us. And I hope you guys heard about the Bell Lab also. So that is one of our innovation center. So Bell Lab is also Nokia's part. So, and we have won almost 9 Nobel Prizes, for our innovations. So this is how we invest in future and we invest in the technologies. And railway is one of the pioneer or one of the most important segments in Nokia actually. So this is end of the presentation. This is my last slide. So we are also having a one running lab with the Doshe One. So yes, there we are, where we are providing doing a testing for the 5G basically. So this is our living lab, we called it FRMCS on track basically with Nokia. So that's it. So any questions, sir, you can ask.
Yeah, I have one question.
Yeah, please, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Havna, Deputy CST MRPC from Mumbai. So first of all, I would like to appreciate Camtek for arranging such a wonderful session. And thank you, Mr. Mahipal from Nokia, for explaining the system so nicely. So can you go back to your slide number 25, where you have explained the ETCS level 2 and LTE?
Okay. Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, exactly. So if we want to implement CBTC using LTE, then I guess this will be the similar network architecture for CBTC also, like CBTC will be compatible with the eNode B, right?
Yes,
so as on date, as we all aware that railway has given the spectrum in the range of 700 megahertz. So do we have the CBTC equipment available in this frequency range as on date?
So ma'am, CBTC equipment, no need to be on a 700 band. What happened, there's a onboard unit of CBTC basically that is there in the loco, and that equipment is connected to the LTE modem, which is there in the 700 band. So we also have an onboard unit of 700, which is going to be installed in the loco.
Okay. And LTE has been released, the specification number 8 was released long back. And still we are on the trial and for CBTC. Why LTE is not popular in CBTC as on date? Because what I know, there are very limited installation, one in China and one on trial in Paris, which are using LTE. So why so? Why so slow progress?
Yes, ma'am. So the reason being, actually, most of the deployments are there for the GSMR in Europe. So GSMR and ETCS too, so they have defined a standards like IRENE standards, that's clearly captured there. So based on the IRENE standard, they use GSMR. Now LTE evolved, yes, release 8 was introduced in 2008, that's true. However, the public safety related features were introduced in release 12. After that, the development has started, and since then they have planning to publish the FRMCS standard. It's almost, I can say, 5 years, happened, just working on the draft specification of the FRMCS. Since 2015, in fact, I'm also aware and attended few of the, presentations or for this FRMCS in 2017 or 18. At that time also, it was planning to be published in 2018. However, because of certain, you know, delays or some, you know, I can say involvement in the technology, so this is further delayed to 2021. Hopefully, by this year end, the FRMCS will be published. Again, these technologies are technology agnostic, I will say, like access technology, you know, agnostic. So CBTC, yes, the LTE is a bit, I can say, delay. And one of the prominent reason for that is most of the operators, train operator I'm talking about, have invested huge money in GSMR in Europe. So most of the, I can say, deployment has happened in the Europe. So they already have a kind of GSMR infrastructure or networks available there, which can provide support up to 2030. So they don't want to invest in that. So that is the one of the reason for the delay also, I can see.
So that means when the quota life of the system will be over, then they might shift to LTE. So
yes, correct. Yeah. That is one of the case for them. But for India, it's kind of like we have not adopted GSMR that profoundly, you can say. So for us, most of our place it's a green field for us.
Yeah. And just one, just my last question. If I consider a route kilometer, a section for 100 route kilometer, and if I want to implement CBTC using LTE or CBTC using Wi-Fi, so what would be the difference in cost?
Okay, ma'am. There's definitely in terms of cost, there's no comparison with the CBTC. No comparison with the Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi is definitely much cheaper as compared to LTE. However, LTE is much more reliable as compared to Wi-Fi. If you required, I can share a presentation on that also. Benefits of LTE over Wi-Fi. For LTE, I can say per kilometer cost would be around 50 lakhs, you can say.
Okay.
I'm saying this budgetary cost to you. So that is based on the configuration, dimensioning, etc. And this is also, I'm considering, you can say, a higher core. I can say not the enterprise core, but the bigger core basically, which can cater up to your 1,000 kilometer or 5,000 kilometer also.
Okay. So, Mahipal, I have just shared my email ID in the chat box. So I request you if you can share more information on LTE, on CBTC using LTE. So please share on my email ID.
All right, well, definitely I will do that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Yeah. Thank you, Vijay. Thank you, Mahipal.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Bhavna.
So, any more questions?
Can I ask one more?
Yeah, please, ma'am.
Okay, yeah. So I, in your slide number 43, you was talking about the network planning and the throughput requirement and all that. I've seen that, yeah. But my question here is, as you informed that E node B, there is a particular, some coverage is there for every node. So if we are going to implement LTE, CBTC with LTE, then it's, you know, in a urban area, line of sight problem is there, and it's very, you know, very overpopulated and dense area. So yes, what extra things we should keep in mind while deciding the number of nodes in the planning?
Okay, so this is why we said it's as a, we considered it as a clutter. So we have different models of, you know, clutter types, I can say. So the areas where we are having a you know, high skyscrapers, you can say high rise buildings or dense urban area, so we consider that clutter as dense urban. And similarly, where we are having a not that high rise building, you can say a few high rise buildings, etc., we consider that as urban. and then a suburban, and then a rural clutter. So these are different categories of clutters we consider. And third one, last one is the forest or vegetation. So based on these clutters, we run, there are certain, you can say, attenuation is associated or losses is associated with these clutters. So we have optimized model of all these, you know, clutter categories. So while doing the RF simulation, our tool will automatically, we just select the clutter type basically, like dense urban we consider, when we select the dense dense urban clutter. So automatically it considered all the losses associated with that dense urban, you know, clutter type. So the coverage will automatically come less in the tool. So they have like inbuilt algorithm already there as per the losses for dense urban. And these models are based on our experience as well as with the, you know, with the actual field data, we optimize these models. So for you, definitely when considering dense urban will have less coverage as compared to rural or open area. So definitely there is some, you know, difference.
Okay, understood. Thank you.
Mahipal, one question is there.
Yes, sir.
What are the frequency ranges which are allotted for this LTE network for railways?
Railway has allocated, right now they just confirmed the band. It's band 28 and the technology is going to be FDD. Basically, it's a 5 plus 5, you can say, for uplink 5 and for downlink 5. So band 28 is from 703 megahertz to 748 megahertz. So there is going to be one slot in this, you know, band basically. So exact slot is not yet confirmed by you know, DOT.
So there must be bandwidth constraint in this band.
No, not bandwidth constraint. I can say 5 megahertz is more than sufficient to, you know, I think our requirements, whatever railway is looking for, that is more than sufficient.
And one more thing.
Yes.
We are using this this OFDMA, na, right?
Yes. So the modulation. Correct. So WCDMA is different. So here, what we are using is OFDMA for the downlink and SCFDMA for the devices, basically. So these are the modulation schemes. And you know, here the structure is like there is a resource block. Resource block consists of, we call it PRV also, PRV. So resource block consists of like 12 cross 15, 180 kilohertz. So each resource block, basically this is the minimum unit allocated to any user while transmitting the data. And that is allocated for 0.5 millisecond, I can say. And this is the minimum unit. So in which, and this is again on the frequency as well as the time domain. And using this orthogonality feature, basically OFDMA more is ortho, because of its orthogonality, we are able to use the same 5 megahertz of channel in all. So like in the site one, we are using a 5 megahertz of channel, right? The same 5 megahertz can be used in the adjacent site also, or adjacent cells also. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Hello.
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay.
So, Gangsar, thank you for giving us opportunity. I think if there is much questions, I'd like to say thank you for the entire railway team. Director sir, Director sir. Hello.
Director sir, hello. I think there is some network issue with me.
Okay. So if there is no much other questions, sir, so we would like to thank some of the complete the entire team for giving us this opportunity and present our solution and also the some architecture. I think hopefully it was useful.
Any other question, please?
No, sir.
Right, Ashish, we can conclude.
Okay, sir. Thanks, Mr. Mahipal ji. Mr. Bhatji from Nokia Enterprises for giving a detailed presentation on LTE technology and its applications in Indian Railways. Thanks to all senior officials from Railways and all other participants for attending the webinar. All participants are requested to provide feedback through the link given in the chat box so that we can improve ourselves in future. Now I request Director S&T Chemtech Shri Vijay Garji to end the meeting.
I sincerely thank all the respected seniors, my colleagues and my juniors. Ji, just one week ki request mein unhone itna badhiya presentation taiyar karke diya. I'm sure jitne bhi logon ne participate kiya, they must have got the understanding of about LTE. And I'm sure ki future mein bhi jab bhi humko help ki zarurat padegi, Bhatji will always be there. So thank you all. Next week again we will be conducting one more webinar. I will again send the link, share the link with all of you. So thank you very much.
Thank you sir, thanks everyone for the time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.